Well, students, in this lecture, we are going to start with this chapter on wave-particle duality. Well, classically, light was always considered to be a wave because all the phenomena which were known earlier, like reflection, refraction, diffraction, interference, polarization, all these phenomena could be explained by considering light as a wave. Until there was this phenomena called as the photoelectric effect. You know what is photoelectric effect, right? When light falls on a metal, electrons are emitted from the surface of the metal. This phenomena is called photoelectric effect. Now, in this phenomena, light behaves as a particle. So, photoelectric effect phenomena could not be explained by considering light as a wave, but it could be explained very easily by considering light as a particle called as photons, each photon having energy E is equal to h nu. This particle theory of light was put forward by Planck to explain the photoelectric effect experiment. So, in photoelectric effect experiment, light behaves as a particle. Whereas in these experiments, light behaves as a wave. So, today we say that light has a dual nature, wave nature as well as a particle nature. So, in some experiments, it behaves like a wave, whereas in certain other experiment, it behaves like a particle. Now, after photoelectric effect, there was this one more experiment called as the Compton effect, in which again light behaves like a particle. So, Compton effect is in one more experiment which can be explained by considering light as a particle and not as a wave. So, what is this Compton effect experiment? Let us see that. So, Compton effect experiment is observed only using light of high energy, for example, like X-rays or gamma rays. Compton effect is not observed by low energy radiation like microwaves, visible light or ultraviolet light. Okay, either using X-rays or gamma rays, this Compton effect experiment is possible to be observed. So, what is this experiment? So, whenever X-rays or gamma rays, monochromatic X-rays or gamma rays of wavelength lambda are incident on a body, which we call it as a scatterer. So, the light which is scattered from this object, coming out of this object, is found to have two wavelengths. One having the same wavelength as the incident radiation, and it is called as an unmodified component because the wavelength is same as the incident. And there's another wavelength, lambda dash, which is greater than the incident wavelength. And this is called as a modified component because it's different from the incident wavelength. So, in simple terms, Compton effect is like this. Suppose green color light, single color light, green color, let us say, is falling on a scatterer. The light coming out of the body, the scattered light, is found to have two colors. One green, same as the incident, and might be another one red in color, which is different from the incident. So, two different colors, two different wavelengths are there in the scattered radiation. Now, this is something which the classical wave theory could not explain. What the wave theory says, if light of green color falls, green color light only should come out. There should be no red color in it. So, this is where the classical wave theory fails in explaining Compton effect. But, we will see later on, the particle theory, Planck's particle theory, that light is made up of photons, could very easily explain this phenomenon of Compton effect. Okay, so just a revision. Compton effect is a phenomenon wherein whenever light of high energy, monochromatic light of high energy falls on an object, a scatterer, the scattered radiation is found to have two components. One, unmodified, having the same wavelength as the incident, and another having a wavelength lambda dash which is greater than the incident wavelength, and that is called as the modified component. So, this phenomenon is called as Compton effect. Now, how did Compton discover this phenomena? He was performing this experiment, Compton effect experiment, wherein he was using monochromatic X-rays from an X-ray tube. So, wavelength X-rays is lambda, and he made them to pass through slits, collimating slits, so that the X-rays become a very fine narrow beam. And this narrow beam of X-rays, he made it incident on a graphite block, a small block of graphite. And then he observed the scattered radiation coming from the graphite block at different angles. So, there was this detector here which was mounted on a circular track which could be rotated right from 0 degrees to 180 degrees. Okay. So, at different angles, Compton detected or measured the wavelength of the X-rays which was scattered. Okay. So what observations did Compton see when he did this experiment? So this is what he saw in this experiment. So at a particular angle theta, so let us say at an angle theta 1, so when the detector was placed at an angle theta 1, so he scanned the different wavelengths which were coming from the scattered radiation, and he found that at two particular wavelengths there were peaks obtained. The first peak was obtained at the same wavelength lambda as the incident x-rays, and there was another peak which was unexpectedly there, which had a wavelength lambda dash which was greater than the incident wavelength. Okay, so he called this as the unmodified component, and the other wavelength which was there, surprisingly, he called it as the modified component. Now, another observation which Compton made was that as the angle, scattering angle theta was increased, so as this angle theta was increased, so suppose let us say the detector is moved over here, so the angle theta is increased, what was observed is that the separation between the lambda and the lambda dash peaks increased. So you can see this case, second case, second diagram here, in which the angle theta is greater than the first angle theta 1. What happened? The lambda position remained the same, lambda peak remained in the same position, but a lambda dash modified component peak shifted further away. So as theta is increased, the separation between the lambda and lambda dash peaks kept on increasing. Third observation which Compton made was that at theta equal to 0 degrees, that is at this position, when we keep the detector over here, so it's called as theta equal to 0 degrees, direct ray, direct beam. So at 0 degrees, only one peak was observed, right? And it's quite simple to understand why this only one peak is observed, because as we have seen over here in this case, as theta is increased, as we keep on increasing the angle theta, the separation between the peaks increases. So conversely, it means that if theta is decreased, as theta is decreased, the separation between the peaks also will decrease. So this peak will keep on coming more and more closer as we keep on decreasing the angle theta. So at theta equal to 0, what will happen is that this peak and this peak will overlap each other. So only one peak is observed. So only lambda peak is observed at theta equal to 0. So these were the three observations made by Compton in his Compton effect experiment. Two peaks were observed. Separation between the peaks kept on increasing as theta increased, scattering angle increased. And at theta equal to 0, only one peak corresponding to the wavelength, incident wavelength lambda, was observed. Okay. So important thing to remember, important thing to note in this experiment, two peaks are obtained, lambda and lambda dash. Classical theory says that only this should be there, this one should not be there, but this is what is observed in Compton effect. Two peaks are there. So let us see now how Compton gave an explanation for the presence of two peaks. So Compton explained Compton effect using the Planck's particle theory of radiation. So he considered this radiation, x-rays or gamma rays, not as waves, but he considered them to be made up of particles called as photons having energy E is equal to h nu. So let us see how Compton explained this Compton effect phenomena. So what Compton considered is that this incident radiation is made up of particles, and these particles are going and colliding elastically with the electrons inside the object, inside this scatterer. So let us try to understand this. Like this. So the incident x-rays or incident gamma rays are made up of particles called photons having energy is equal to h nu, and then these photons are going and colliding elastically with electrons inside this scatterer. Where are these electrons from? Remember, all objects, all matter is made up of atoms, and atoms, inside them they have a nucleus, positively charged nucleus in the center, and electrons going around in circular orbits around the nucleus. So these electrons are the electrons or orbital electrons inside the atoms. So there are many such electrons. So when these photons go and collide with the electrons, during the collision, the photons transfer some of their energy to the electron. So therefore, the photon which comes out will have a lesser energy. So once again, I repeat, the incident photons from the incident radiation go and collide with the electrons inside this scatterer, and during the collision, the photon transfer some of the energy to the electron. So naturally, the photon which will come out will have an energy which is lesser than the incident photon. Why? Because some of the energy of this photon is taken by the electron which the photon had collided with. So now, the scattered photon will have a lesser energy compared to the incident photon. So we can say that E dash, scattered photon energy, is less than the incident photon energy E, which in turn, see now H over here is the Planck's constant. So H is a constant, cannot vary. So if E dash is less than E, it automatically implies that nu dash, frequency nu dash is less than the scattered photo frequency nu dash is less than the incident photon frequency nu, which in turn implies that lambda dash is greater than lambda. Scattered photon's wavelength is greater than the incident photon's wavelength. Why? Because if nu dash is less than nu, now nu and frequency and wavelength are inversely proportional to each other. So if nu dash is less than nu, it implies that lambda dash is greater than lambda. Okay. Because of the inverse relation between frequency and wavelength. So what do we get from here? The scattered wavelength of the scattered photon is greater than the wavelength of the incident photon. So this explains the modified component lambda dash, how we get the lambda dash coming from the scattered radiation. But then there's one more thing which we need to explain. In the scattered radiation, not only lambda dash is there, modified component is there, but also there are some photons with same wavelength lambda. Now, just now we explained why some photons come out with wavelength lambda dash, modified component. Now, we also need to explain why some photons also come out with wavelength lambda. So, how do we explain unmodified component? Now, this also Compton gave a simple explanation for it. So, this is how we explain the modified unmodified component. So, if the photons from the incident X-rays or gamma rays, incident radiation, they go and collide with the electrons inside the scatterer, then during the photon-electron collision, energy transfer takes place and the photon comes out with less energy. So that's what we have talked about the modified component. Now, in case of unmodified component, if the photon goes and collides with the nucleus, now remember in this material, electrons are there and there is a positively charged nucleus also, right? The electrons are going around the nucleus. So in case the photon goes and collides with the nucleus, now during this collision between photon and nucleus, there is no energy transfer between photon and nucleus. So photon does not transfer any energy to the nucleus. Why? Because the mass of the nucleus is very large. Okay. Now if you remember, two colliding bodies, there is energy transfer between two colliding bodies if the masses of the two bodies is comparable. Now, photon is a particle of light. Theoretically, the mass of a photon is zero. So we can say that photon is a very light particle. Now, nucleus here, which the photon is colliding with, is a very heavy particle, very heavy mass. So photon mass and nucleus mass are incomparable. So therefore, during the collision between photon and nucleus, there is no energy transfer. So what will happen to the photon? The photon just falls on the nucleus and just comes out, rebounds, bounces back from it with the same energy. So there is no energy lost by the photon. So the incident photon and the scattered photon will have the same energy and hence the same wavelength. So this is how we explain the unmodified component lambda. So how is that some photons come out with the same wavelength? It is because these photons are colliding with the nucleus. So if the photon collides with the nucleus, we get same energy, same wavelength coming out. If photon collides with electron, now electron is a light particle and photon also is a light particle. So during electron and photon collision, energy transfer between photon and electron takes place. So photon transfers the energy to the electron. So photon comes out with lesser energy means greater wavelength. Lesser energy means greater wavelength. So that is how we explained already the modified component. So remember once again, summary, unmodified component is explained by photon from the incident radiation colliding with the nucleus inside the scatterer. Whereas the modified component is explained by photons from the incident radiation colliding with the electrons inside the scatterer. So in this case, the wavelength which comes out is greater, lambda dash is greater than the incident radiation. So this is how we explain both the unmodified component lambda and modified component lambda dash. So that's what is written over here. So modified component arises because of photon colliding with electron, whereas unmodified component arises because of photon colliding with massive nucleus. So both the types of photons are there in the scattered radiation, modified as well as unmodified. This arises due to photon nucleus collision, whereas this arises due to photon electron collision. Thank you.